Action-packed week in Quinnipiac sports. Both hockey teams had crucial ECAC games.
And both the men's and women's basketball teams look to start February off on a positive note.
That's not all. Tons more to come. Sports Paws starts right now. Countdown to the ECAC playoffs for the men's ice hockey team. 24 days, 21 hours, and 25 minutes, as you can see it right there. Let's take a look at the ECAC standings as the Quinnipiac men's ice hockey team entered Friday night's game against Brown. There you can see it. Quinnipiac at 17 points, followed closely by Cornell again. To remind you folks, the top four teams in the ECAC are guaranteed a bye into the quarterfinals round of the playoffs. And why don't we get it started with that? Good evening, everyone, and welcome to Sports Paws.
I'm Matt Halpin.
And I'm Andrew Badillo. Matt, we just showed the ECAC standings as of Thursday. Quinnipiac took care of Brown 1-0 and stayed in fourth place in the standings at 19 points.
Well, every game is crucial with the playoffs less than 1 month away. The Battle of Whitney Part 1 was Saturday night, another crucial game for Quinnipiac as it took on Yale. Let's get right into it. Kyle Levasseur caught up with a fan before the game. Let's take a look.
Have you ever been to a Quinnipiac Yale game before?
Yeah. I've been here. Quinnipiac Yale game here a lot also.
Yeah. And who has the better team?
Quinnipiac.
Right off the bat here in the first period, Yale is going to get a 5-minute major. You cannot do that. A chippy game from the start, of course. Rafferty over to Prisky. Power play goal from the point. Absolute snipe. 1-1. That tied it up. Second period now. Rafferty's going to give it away, Yale, and Truel, crisis averted. Just kidding, says Yale, they'll stuff it in. 2-1, Yale is hyped. Quinnipiac has a hole to dig themselves out of. But the thing is, they do. Another snipe from Chase Prisky from the point. He is on fire tonight, his second of the game. We're gonna see now freshman Nick Germain. He's not gonna ask questions. That's his first collegiate goal in such a big game. And you know what, why don't we give him one more for good measure. Nick Germain, another goal, his second collegiate goal. Tim Clifton's gonna score another. Quinnipiac BTL 5-2 at Yale.
Yeah, our team has been getting a lot of power plays this year, so we knew we had to start capitalizing on those, and we go out every day after practice and kind of work on our kind of 1-2 punch, and we've been able to capitalize lately and help our team win, so that's all we try to do.
We're going to see the ECAC standings as of today. Let's see where everything stands. So with that, Quinnipiac remains in fourth place, still just barely ahead of Cornell, but they inch closer to Harvard. Union still at the top, St. Lawrence second, and of course bringing up the bottom is Colgate, Princeton, and Dartmouth. It looks like they're not going to move up anytime soon.
Cornell, another great week, and Matt, they've been on fire lately, hanging with Quinnipiac.
They
for
absolutely
that
have.
Spot.
Yeah, they absolutely have, and they are inching closer. Quinnipiac, no room to breathe. Let's see the USHO.com poll nationally. Well, we see here Quinnipiac at 19th place. It's not quite where they expected to be at the beginning of the season, but it'll have to do. They're going to start having to climb up. As you know, the top 16 teams make it to the national tournament. That's not what you want. They're going to have to start moving out of it.
All right, Matt. Well, why don't we move it along now to women's ice hockey. They were taking on Princeton at home Tuesday up at the bank. It was Kids Day, but check out the weather, Matt. It was a little bit wild on Tuesday. Cars all around Hampton getting stuck in the snow. This car was on Cannon Drive. These two cars were on Cannon Drive, can't even get up the hill. There was an accident actually at the foot of Sherman Avenue where the entrance to the arena is. And the Bobcats, well, they came out pretty sluggish right at the beginning of the game. Kate McKenzie caught flat-footed. Princeton's gonna have a really good opportunity, but Sydney Rossman and the rest of the Deeps are able to clear it. Again, McKenzie a little bit slow to this puck as an icing is negated by Princeton right there. And well, here on the 2-on-1, TTC in front of Emma Woods, you expect the goal, right? But well, there's a slashing penalty right there. Not really sluggish, but you expect Quinnipiac to get a better result from that. And without Quinnipiac being able to capitalize on our opportunities, there's Princeton. Kelsey Colzer putting Princeton up 1-0 in the second period. We go all downhill from there for the Bobcats, not really able to generate anything on offense. This will be Princeton's third goal of the afternoon. It would be Molly Contini, 3-0. Quinnipiac, or 3-0 Princeton, rather. That would be the final in this one. Cass Turner after the game.
Yeah, you know, I think today we took a pretty big step in terms of where we were in our game against Merrimack, and but we were playing a good hockey team. Maybe we didn't take a big enough step and didn't make enough plays, but you know, our goal is ultimately we want to be sure we're playing our absolute best hockey at the end of the season, and so I saw some good things and some things that we're certainly going to look to improve as we go forward.
All right, why don't we get it right into the USCHO.com women's national poll. We just did the men's, as you can see. There it is. Quinnipiac at number 9 in the poll, followed by, well, let's start up top. Wisconsin, Minnesota, Duluth, St. Lawrence rounding up the top 3. Clarkson, 4. Minnesota at 5. Boston College at 6. Cornell at 7. Robert Morris at 8. Quinnipiac at 9. And then Princeton at 10.
The Quinnipiac women's ice hockey team took on Brown, a much different game from that of Princeton. We're going to see it here at the bank. We're going to focus on Megan Turner. She had a huge game, ice in her veins as she came out here. The assistant captain, junior, she had a big night. We're about to see more. First period now. Megan Turner is going to go into a scrum on the boards. Somehow gets out of this, the three defenders right in front of the net. She's not going to miss there. Yeah, keep trying. Good play. Here we go into the second period. Emma Greco is going to take a shot. It's redirected, falls to the feet of Turner. She scores her second of the game. At this point, it's 5-0 QU. This one's over. Third period. Why don't they just add to it for good measure? Megan Turner in front of the net. She's very good at this, blocking off the goaltender. And bats it right out of the air. That's a great goal by Megan Turner. A hat trick, 9-0 is the final. Quinnipiac are going to switch up the momentum from that which they lost in the game against Princeton.
All right, Matt. Well, Quinnipiac, it was a busy week for the women's ice hockey team. 3 games is the final one against Yale, opposite that of the men's team. They are home. First period, let's take it. Yale is going to be on the rush here, and Eden Murray, take a look at this one. Snipe top shelf past Sydney Rossman. She had no chance. Eden Murray, nice goal. 1-0 Yale. First period still, Melissa Samuskevich is going to get the puck right there at the top of the blue line. Nice little move. And right over the pad and under the glove of the Yale goaltender. Nice goal. 1-1 tie. Second period now. QU back on offense. We got the aerial look at this one. Kate McKenzie, ding and in. Past the Yale goaltender, nice goal there, 2-1 QU. Moving on to the third period, Taryn Bumgart is in on a 2-on-1, and hey, she's gonna keep it, and another snipe. QU was on absolute fire in this one, shooting the puck right past the Yale goaltender. They would go on to win 4-1. And when we come back on Sports Balls, the women's basketball team did something last week that they haven't done in 2 seasons. We'll show you what it was.
And the red hot duo of Mikey Dixon and Peter Kiss were on fire once again, but would they be enough to get the team past Niagara and Fairfield?
Find out when we come back on Sports Pause.
Coming up on Bobcat Breakdown.
Coming up on Bobcat Breakdown.
And welcome into Studio 125.
So what? So what?
Score 40 points in a basketball game. We all know you play Quinnipiac intramurals. We all know you love to shoot the rock.
Well, if you think that's the most ridiculous thing you've ever heard, what I'm about to say, I guess, is going to be pretty ridiculous in your book. But I'm going to say yes, there is a controversy. I'm
line, getting ready to punch the ball as it lands right in front of another Monmouth player.
Coming up
on hashtag that.
Source for Quinnipiac's entertainment news. All this and more
coming up on the
9:30 newscast.
It's 9:30 Eastern, and you know what that means. Sports Paws is on the air.
Ball played up the middle. Iman Whalen with a little cheek off the play.
Preseason just boils down to going after another national championship and not necessarily focusing on the one before.
MJ, it is time for our favorite part of the show. It's the top five plays of the week brought to you by B&D Deli, home of the Q-Dog.
Let's talk about the first play you want to break down.
Yeah, let's break it down right away.
But the one name I'm going to throw out there is a freshman, Mika Maples.
Welcome back to Sports Paws. Matt, Brogan Rafferty has been an absolute star for the men's ice hockey team this season. The young man from Illinois coming in and filling the void left by Devontae's.
Absolutely, and the freshman defenseman leads all ECAC freshman defensemen in assists. MJ Baird caught up with him to find out more.
Quinnipiac's most successful freshman defender this season is Brogan Rafferty. Rafferty hails from Dundee, Illinois, and got his chance to play junior hockey in the USHL with the Bloomington Thunder. The best part, the Thunder play only 2.5 hours from his hometown.
Oh, it was great. I mean, my family got to come down a lot and watch me play, and it was always good seeing them and seeing people that usually don't get to see me play, and that was a good opportunity for me, and I had a lot of fun in Bloomington that year.
Oftentimes, players are rated based on their trends. For Rafferty, his trend is being a double-digit point scorer, but not necessarily booming numbers coming in the goal category.
I got Prisky on my left and Craig on my right, so those are two really good players as well, proven players. And, you know, it's not very hard for me to give them the puck and they can put it in the back of the net.
Rafferty excels finding the open scorer instead of the back of the net himself. He leads all Bobcats in assists, is tied for the team lead in points, and is second among all ECAC freshman defenders in the same categories.
I think I'm an offensive defenseman, but I don't necessarily have the goal-scoring touch, so I just give it to the guys who do, and they do the work for me.
The transition from Illinois to Connecticut so far has been noteworthy for Rafferty, but his ultimate goal is to win it all.
I want to win a national championship really bad. They were so close last year, and hearing them talk about their trip down to Tampa and how close they were makes me really hungry to win, and I just want to win any kind of championship I can, the ECAC title, the Cleary Cup, national championship, Frozen Four, so anything. I just want to win, and whatever I have to do to make that happen is what I'll try to do.
But in order to accomplish this hefty goal, the Bobcats have to finish the regular season strong. Quinnipiac has 5 ECAC games remaining and are currently sitting 4th in the conference standings. One of the remaining games, at home against rival Yale. But for Rafferty and the Bobcats, it's more than a rivalry. It's business.
We know where they are in the standings. We they're right behind us, and we have a couple teams on our heels we want to be in the top 4 for the bye for the UCAC playoffs. So we're going to do everything we can to win that game, especially. And at the end, it's a 2-point game, but in reality, it's a 4-point game because they don't get the 2 points.
The Quinnipiac Bobcats have 5 ECAC games remaining on their schedule. The Bobcats currently sit at 4th in the conference standings with 21 points. And if the playoffs began today, Quinnipiac would obtain a first-round bye. From the High Point Solutions Arena, I'm MJ Baird, Q30 Sports.
The Quinnipiac men's basketball team took on Niagara at home this past week. Let's check out the highlights from that one. Now Quinnipiac, very good against Niagara historically. First half now, Peter Kiss, the freshman, gonna drive the net, gets fouled, and won. Great play by Peter Kiss. He would miss the free throw, but what a play.
He's been on fire all season.
Oh, absolutely. Peter Kiss, good move, crossover right there, and shoves the 3 right in the defender's face. What a great play. Now here's Pete Kiss again in the corner. Oh, of course, 3-pointer. What a play. Have a day. And here's a cross-court pass. Great play. Wow, Mikey Dixon, another 3-pointer. Quinnipiac was on fire for this one. The rookies really putting on a show.
It's really been Dixon and Kiss who have fueled this sort of resurgence from last year for this game.
Absolutely. Now we're going to see Robinson, another 3-pointer, and I mean, it was a close game. Only 8-point difference, but a great offensive display by Quinnipiac. We're going to see Chase Daniels after the game in a second.
I think we all got to pick it up. Like I said last game in the interview, you know, Donovan was a big key to our team, and he went out, unfortunately. So everyone has to step up and pick up the slack.
Well, Matt, as you saw in that highlight, Peter Kiss was on fire, and he would continue his torrid season, his torrid play in the team's win tonight against Fairfield. The freshman guard scored double-digit points for the second straight game, scoring 18 points and grabbing 12 rebounds, including this game-winning runner with less than 2 seconds left. Quinnipiac would go on to win 73-71. As you can see here, Kiss driving to the lane, and he's going to get a nice little floater right over there over the Fairfield defense. Great play from the freshman point guard. And now we're going to bring in our men's basketball analyst, Dylan Fearon, to discuss a little bit of what's been going on with this men's basketball team. Dylan, how are you?
Any night talking about basketball with you guys is a great one. Thanks for having me.
Fantastic, my man. Why don't we recap this Fairfield game? You know, Quinnipiac has been up and down this year when it comes to winning. They win one, and then they'll lose one. But it's been flatlining a little bit lately. What'd you see in this game?
Well, Donovan Smith was out. Abdullahi Bundu was out, too. So two of their front court guys out for this game. And you would think Fairfield would have an advantage on the rebounding and on the glass, but they didn't. Quinnipiac out-rebounded them by 12. So it looked good there in terms of the front court play of Chase Daniels. And Jaquan Jones came off the bench and delivered with 19 minutes. He was productive on points and rebounds as well. Fairfield was up 10 at halftime. And it really looked like Fairfield was going to go on and win this game at home. But Quinnipiac's resiliency, their perseverance, their fight was tremendous in the second half. They go on an 11-0 run to tie the game at 65. And then Peter Kiss, as you said, Andrew, wins the game with a floater with 1.9 seconds remaining. You have to love the fight from this team, who's now 7-7 in MAC play after being 6-14 last year, losing six players, including their top player, Giovanni McLean, and their top perimeter defender in James Ford Jr. You got to love it.
Now, Dylan, already a better record than last year for this Quinnipiac team, a huge win. Brings them back to 500, as you just said. What do you think this means for the rest of the season?
Well, their last six regular season games were all against teams that they should be favored in or the underdog by only a point or two. You look at the schedule, they play Rider twice, who's below them in the standings. They play Marist. They play Manhattan, who's behind them. They play St. Peter's at home, too, who they only lost to on the road by 2 points at the Anatelli Center in Jersey City. So they should be favored in a lot of games. If they can go 4-2 in these last six games and be 11-9 going into Albany for the MAC tournament, they could have a bye and they could have a lot of confidence going in. I mean, the key in the MAC tournament is, do you have senior guards? Do you play good defense? And Quinnipiac, let's be honest here, doesn't have that seniority that other teams in the MAC do, like a Monmouth, like an Iona, like a Siena, like a Canisius. But their defense was good in the second half, and Mikey Dixon and Peter Kiss are tremendous freshmen. So we'll see. If they can go 4-2 and be 11-9, that'll be great for their confidence going to Albany.
All right, Dylan, so you touched on how the schedule you think is going to favor Quinnipiac, but does the injury situation with Donovan Smith really put a damper on this team's hopes going forward?
At first, I thought yes, but if you look at their last two games, they've out-rebounded both their teams, both their oppositions by 12 rebounds each, and they're 2-0 in those games. So going in after the injury, after Donovan Smith broke his foot and had surgery on that last week and probably is done for the season in his career, you thought, wow, they're going to be really banged up. It's not looking good. They go 2-0 in these two games against Niagara and Fairfield. Niagara 7-7. St. Peter's is coming home. I mean, they could be 8-7, and you look and you think, wow, they could win any game, and they can go far in the MAC tournament. At first, I thought yes, but now I'm second guessing myself.
Thank you so much, Dylan, for joining us on Sports Paws.
You're welcome.
Excellent insight as always. And coming up on Sports Paws, we take a break from winter sports. Tennis and track were in action this weekend.
And we once again have our top five plays of the week. See which plays made the cut. Don't go away. We'll be right back.
Hello, Quinnipiac hockey fans, and welcome to the Neutral Zone.
Definitely St. Lawrence, and I think you're going to see the test coming up real soon.
It might be having a bit of an adjustment issue without that CBS line, but don't count them out.
At High Point Solutions Arena in Game 2 of Quinnipiac versus Northeastern Series.
9:30 Eastern, and you know what that means. Sports Paws is on the air.
Ball played up the middle. Iman Whalen with a little cheek off the putt.
Preseason just boils down to going after another national championship and not necessarily focusing on the one before.
MJ, it is time for our favorite part of the show. It's the top five plays of the week brought to you by B&B Deli, home of the Q-Dog.
Let's talk about the first play you want to break down.
Yeah, let's break it down right away.
But the one name I'm going to throw out there is a freshman, Mika Maples.
Coming up on Bobcat Breakdown.
Coming up on Bobcat Breakdown.
And welcome into Studio 125.
So what? So what?
If you score 40 points in a basketball game, we all know you play Quinnipiac Intramurals. We all know you love to shoot the rock.
Well, if you think that's the most ridiculous thing you've ever heard, what I'm about to say, I guess, is going to be pretty ridiculous in your book. But I'm going to say, yes, there is a controversy. I'm
getting ready to punch the ball as it lands right in front of another Monmouth player.
Welcome back to Sports Paws. The Quinnipiac women's basketball team traveled to Webster Bank Arena for a game against Fairfield. Sierra Goodwill was there with the story.
A stone-cold shooting performance for Quinnipiac women's basketball, which just dropped its second straight conference game to Fairfield on the road. Head coach Trisha Fabry says her team needs to get back to the fundamentals.
We just need to stop talking about things that aren't going our way, and we really need to just get it done and do your job.
Quinnipiac strayed away from its signature gold rush substitutions just about halfway through the game. Some players couldn't stay out of foul trouble, and no one seemed to have the hot hand.
You know, is that something that we need to go to and go away from? Because ultimately, you're going to need players that are going to be confident in big spots when you get closer to March.
And two of those players that Fabry leans on are Aaron McClure and Paula Strautmane. Both of them finished Thursday night's game with four personal fouls.
And I have a lot of trust and faith in all my players, just because we've had just incredible amounts of success. And we're at this part of the season where we're facing incredible adversity.
This is just the third time that Quinnipiac has dropped two straight MAC games since it joined the conference in the 2013 and 2014 season. Trisha Fabry says she's really missing the grit and versatility from Brittany Johnson, especially on the offensive end.
She's really as gritty as they come and fearless out on the court. And I think a piece to this. But we've been here in terms of winning and success, and you've got to battle that.
Johnson will be sidelined for the rest of the season with a knee injury, but Fabry is confident that the players and her team are determined to get back to their winning ways.
We've got a lot of young ladies that, again, are used to having success, that are winners, and that we have a lot of belief.
Quinnipiac has a one-day turnaround before it welcomes Monmouth to Hampden on Saturday. The Hawks dealt the Bobcats their first loss of the season back in January. Reporting from Webster Bank Arena in Bridgeport, Sierra Goodwill, Q30 Sports.
Andrew, another game dropped by Quinnipiac against a team that is lesser than them on paper. What do you take from this?
Certainly, Matt. It's actually the first time since late 2015, that Quinnipiac has lost two straight conference games back to back, and it's only the third time since Quinnipiac joined the MAC that they've lost two games in a row. So Trisha Fabry's squad certainly looking to get off the schneid against Monmouth. And Monmouth and Quinnipiac actually have a lot of history dating back to last year's MAC tournament, where Maria Napolitano was knocked out of that game. She suffered a season-ending injury and was missed in the MAC championship game against Iona. And then earlier in this season, Monmouth handed Quinnipiac its first MAC loss of the season. So Quinnipiac certainly looking for a bit of revenge, so to say, in this game. And why don't we take it to the highlight? Quinnipiac taking on Monmouth in a rematch from earlier in the season. First quarter now. QU rebounds, it'll be tipped by Paula Strutmany out to Carly Fabry, who bang, hits the three, and that's good to see for Quinnipiac after it struggled so bad against Fairfield, but from behind the arc. Here we go, Quinnipiac passing the ball around. Jen Fay for three again. Quinnipiac solid behind the arc early, good signs. Heading on to the second half, Aaron McClure with a shot. The rebound to Paula Strutmany to Brittany Martin, over to Morgan Manns, who nails it again. Those are That's got to look good. Patricia Fabry's squad putting in threes. Monmouth would really have no answer for Quinnipiac all day. Quinnipiac would go on to win by a final score of 74-54, avenging its early season loss against Monmouth. Quinnipiac is now 11-3 in the MAC.
Moving on now to spring sports. The women's track and field team competed in the Jeg and Jack tournament hosted by Yale University. Sophomore Francine Jacques shined for the Bobcats, finishing second in both of the events that she competed in. Another standout, freshman Mika Maples, who was also on the women's rugby team, broke her own record for shot put by 0.01 meters.
The men's tennis team's spring season is in full swing. This past weekend, Quinnipiac faced off against St. John's and Brown. The Johnnies came out and torched the Bobcats 6-1. Kyle Alper, the only Bobcat to win his singles match. Against Brown, it was much of the same. The Bears swept the Bobcats in every single doubles and singles match to win 7-0. Quinnipiac has the weekend off to regroup before MAC play resumes. It plays Niagara February 18.
The Quinnipiac women's tennis team begins their spring season on February 11th as they host Seton Hall. The Pirates are already 3 games into their season, losing the first but winning the last two by very sizable margins. 3 of the 10 Bobcat players are freshmen and will look to prove themselves early. An action-packed weekend for Quinnipiac sports and plenty of awesome highlights, which brings us to everybody's favorite time, the top 5 plays of the week, brought to you by B&D Deli Works. Open for breakfast and lunch. Come on in and try the Quinnipiac panini or the Q-Dog sub.
All right, Matt, why don't you start it off with number 5?
All right, at number 5, we're going to have Peter Kiss. We saw before, he is just going to cross up a Niagara defender and shoot a 3 like it's nothing.
Guy was on fire all week, and as a matter of fact, all season. Number 4 play, Quinnipiac women's hockey. We saw it earlier in the show. Megan Turner had a day there, sliding a goal underneath the Brown goaltender's pads. She would get another one for her second right there, tipping it in at the front of the crease, and why not for a third goal here, using a little bit of those Canadian silky hands right there. Ding, right in the goal. Some baseball, some lacrosse, whatever you want to call it right there. Nice job, Megan Turner. 3 goals for the top 4 play of the week.
And at number 3, big game for Yale and Quinnipiac women's hockey alike. And right here, we're going to see Eden Murray, an absolute snipe. Nothing is stopping that ever. What a goal.
All right, number 2 play. Ball movement was absolutely fantastic down here. Peter Kiss all the way down to Abilai Bundu to Danny Harris, all the way in the corner for Mikey Dixon for the tray. Nice shot there. Mikey Dixon, again, has been on fire all season for the Bobcats.
And number 1 against Yale, Chase Prisky. Not one, but we're going to see 2 lasers, absolute lasers from the point. Quinnipiac's going to go on to win in part. Thank you to him.
Washington Capitals draft pick, absolutely on fire all season for the Bobcats.
And only a sophomore, too. Plenty of time left. Unfortunately, that's all the time we have tonight. Join us next week for another action-packed edition of Sports Paws.
For more information, please follow us on Twitter at Sports Paws and at Q30 Sports.
Also, be sure to visit our website at Q30Television.com. For Andrew Badillo, I'm Matt Halpin. We'll see you next time here on Sports Paws.